Electric cars are taking over. They're getting nines in the quarter mile. Oh my God! But how do they work? The electric car might seem like a relatively new fad hitting the car world, but they're actually a lot older than you might think. In 1834, Professor Sebrandus Stratting of Groningen in the Netherlands and his assistant Christopher Becker created a small-scale electrical car powered by non-rechargeable primary cells. William Morrison of Des Moines, Iowa, built the first successful electric automobile in the United States in 1891. And by 1897, most of New York's taxis were electric powered. It's crazy! Before we get into how electric cars work, we need to understand how a battery works. You can't store electricity, but you can store electrical energy in the chemicals inside a battery. There are three main components of a battery. Two terminals, or nodes, made of different chemicals, typically metals, the anode and the cathode. And then there's the electrolyte, which separates these terminals. The electrolyte is there to put the different chemicals of the anode and the cathode into contact with one another in a way that the chemical potential can equilibrate.
Words.
During a discharge of electricity, the chemical on the anode releases electrons to the negative terminal and ions in the electrolyte. Meanwhile, at the positive terminal, the cathode accepts electrons, completing the circuit for the flow of electrons, converting stored chemical energy into useful electrical energy. And that's what generates an electric current. It took a while before we'd improved battery technology enough that we could power a vehicle to travel practical distances. But guess what? We got them! The batteries in most hybrids and most fully electric cars, I'm looking at you, Elon, look like this. This metal case holds a long spiral comprising three thin sheets pressed together. Inside the case, these sheets are submerged in an organic solvent, often ether, that acts as the electrolyte. The separator is a very thin sheet of micro-perforated plastic. The positive electrode is made of lithium cobalt oxide. The negative electrode is made of carbon. When the battery charges, ions of lithium move through the electrolyte from the positive electrode to the negative electrode and attach to the carbon. During discharge, the lithium ions move back to the lithium cobalt oxide from the carbon. It's the same principle as any other battery, but because these batteries can store so much electric energy as chemical energy, lithium ion batteries are what helped electric cars make the leap from novelty to reality. And the great thing about lithium ion batteries is that they can recharge over and over and over and over and over. The lithium ion batteries in the Tesla battery pack are actually super similar to the rechargeable batteries that you'd find at the store. They're also commonly used in vapes. Each cell contains 4.2 volts and about 30 amps. What does that mean? Electricity flows like water, so let's think of where we store water. In a reservoir. Here's a reservoir behind a dam. The water back here is like the voltage in a battery. It's like a stored charge. If we let some water out of the dam, we can measure the rate of flow. In a battery, this current's measured in amps. On a battery, amps measures capacity. That's pretty much how quickly the energy can flow out of it. If I put more water in the dam, the flow can still be limited, so a greater voltage can be limited by amperage. Also, if we increase the flow without increasing the charge, we run out of juice before it does us any good! In a battery cell, amps measures capacity, basically how well the current can flow. Wiring cells together can increase either voltage, the energy stored, or amperage, the flow of current, or both. If I wire a battery in series, I'm doubling the voltage while maintaining the same capacity rating. If I wire a battery in parallel, I'm doubling the amperage while maintaining the same voltage rating. 7,104 cells in the Tesla Model S battery are wired in a combination of parallel and series over 16 modules to increase both voltage and amperage to 1,500 amps and 400 volts. That's a lot of juice! But how do they move? Back in the early 1800s, everybody who's anybody was screwing around with electricity and the resulting currents. So it wasn't long before people realized wrapping wires and sending currents through them generated magnetic fields. If you've ever tried to touch two magnets' north ends, well, you know that there's a tangible physical force that magnetic fields can generate. Electric motors use this force to actuate motion. The Tesla Model S uses a motor first invented by Nikola Tesla about 100 years ago, the induction motor. The motor consists of two parts, the rotor and the stator. The rotor is a series of conduction bars short-circuited by N-rings. A three-phase AC pulse is given to the stator. This alternating current produces a four-pole rotating magnetic field, or RMF. The electricity running through the stator induces current on the rotor's metal bars. Just like the magnets can attract or repel to cause movement, the rotating field of the stator causes movement in the now charged rotor. In an induction motor, the rotor is always just behind the RMF. The speed of the rotor is determined by the frequency of the AC current through the stator. When you hit the gas, you're actually increasing the frequency of current. An inverter switches the direct current from the batteries to an alternating current to drive the motor. It sits right by the motor, and it's got all the guts to determine the frequency of current, which determines the speed of the rotor, and the amplitude of the current, which affects the power output of the rotor. And that's determined by a variable frequency drive attached to all this right here. The only points of contact are the bearings that keep the rotor in place. There's no other touching going on between the rotor and the stator, so it's hard for them to wear out. And unlike a conventional engine whose usable torque dwells only within a limited rev range, usually under 8,000 RPM, the Tesla motor can effectively produce force to a rev range up to 18,000 RPM, so there's no need for shifting or torque converters. Also, unlike conventional engines that convert up and down or side to side motion of the pistons to rotational movement, the induction motor produces exclusively rotational force, which means almost all of that can be turned to forward motion when the wheels hit the road. Traditional internal combustion engines can weigh up to 600 pounds. A Tesla Model S motor can generate 362 horsepower and only weighs about 70 pounds. But you gotta remember, they're getting all that juice for those horses from a 1,200 pound battery. Even with that massive battery, the Tesla Model S's 443 pound-feet of torque and 416 horsepower allows you to get to 60 miles an hour in 4.2 seconds in a sedan. Tesla says their biggest concern discharging all that energy and spinning the rotors at 18,000 RPM is heat. So most of the components, including the motor, the frequency drive, and the battery are liquid cooled, so they don't overheat. Oh, and here's the other thing about the Teslas. The induction motor, when it's not producing movement at the wheels, can be spun by the wheels, which makes it run like the alternator in your car, recharging the lithium-ion battery. So more motors means, yes, you're getting more power through the wheels, but it also means more charge coming back to the battery when you're rolling and braking. It's responsible! But making these cars and charging them will also cause emissions. There's no such thing as totally green cars. Well, you're right. There is no such thing as a truly carbon neutral car. But even factoring the carbon created manufacturing the cars, electric cars have a significantly smaller carbon footprint than gasoline-powered cars. And the process is getting more efficient all the time. If you want to help Donut make more great content, check out Brilliant.org. They sponsored this episode. Heck, not just sponsored, but the information on Brilliant actually helped us write this one. I brushed up for this episode by going through practice problems for electricity and magnetism. How do you think I learned how to do this? And then I searched the user-generated explanations to further my understanding of how this all works. Actually working through problems makes the concepts so much clearer, more than just reading about them. The community wants to help you, to challenge you, and inspire you. What better way is there to get excited about math and science. Go to brilliant.org/sciencegarage and sign up for free. Also, the first 200 people to go to the link will get 20% off their annual premium subscription. I'll see you there. Brilliant. Hit this button to subscribe to Donut so you never miss an episode of Science Garage. Follow me on Instagram at BizBardo. Follow Donut at Donut Media. Get yourself some shirts. We got plenty of new stuff coming at shop.donut.media. We talked about vaping. Check out this up to speed on the WRX. Also, check out this new car show on the Tesla Model 3. Don't tell my wife I still put batteries on my tongue.